Missouri River Energy Services, a not-for-profit utility providing electricity and energy services to municipal utilities in South Dakota and throughout the region. SDN Communications, integrating phone and data technology for your office. Learn more at sdncommunications.com.
You're watching a production of South Dakota Public Broadcasting.
State House program funding provided by the South Dakota Bar Foundation, the educational and charitable arm of South Dakota lawyers and judges.
Welcome to South Dakota Public Broadcasting's gavel-to-gavel coverage of the South Dakota Senate. As lawmakers debate bills delivered to the Senate today, you can learn the history behind those bills by visiting us online at sdpb.org. Once there, just go to our State House link where all bills delivered this session have been archived. Let's now turn to the South Dakota Senate for gavel-to-gavel coverage.
And leading us in the Pledge of Allegiance to our great nation's flag is Alex McClory from Elk Point.
Let us pray. O Lord, as we come humbly before you today, we pray that you will be with each senator and give them the wisdom, the courage, and the strength to do what is needed to help this state grow. And Lord, we pray that each person who comes to present will have ideas that will help the senators to get that job done. And Lord, more than anything else, we pray that all people in the gallery will enjoy and understand the way this process goes. Guide and direct each person. Amen.
Amen.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America, and to the republic for which it stands, one nation under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thanks, Alex. Secretary, please call the roll.
Bogalka, Bradford, Brown, Buell, Donnell, Curd, Ewing, Frerichs, Heineman, Holeen, Hunhoff, Jensen, Chuck Jones, Tom Jones, Kirkaby, Krebs, Lederman, Lucas, Maher, Monroe, Nordstrup, Umdahl, Otten, Peters, Rampelberg, Rave, Broden, Soholt, Solano, Sutton, Tiedemann, Thiessen, Van Gerpen, Valley, Welke, White. Mr. President, quorum present.
Approval of the journal, please.
Mr. President, the Committee on Legislative Procedure respectfully reports that the Secretary of the Senate has had under consideration the Senate Journal of the 14th day. All errors, typographical or otherwise, are duly marked in the temporary journal for correction, and we hereby move the adoption of the report. Respectfully, Corey Brown, Chair.
All those in favor of adoption signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Those opposed, nay. Motion carried. Welcome, everyone, in the gallery and watching over live stream and on the internet to your South Dakota Senate. As I'm fond of saying, you had a choice today, and you're the bright ones. You came to the right place. Right, senators? Huh? That's it. We're sure glad that you're here. There are a number of people we'd like to introduce today. It's a big day here in the Capitol for a number of reasons. A patriotic day. We have American Legion reception, and we also have are dining out. But let me start with a recognition of liberties and organizations that are involved in that. Behind me, I'm going to introduce two people, and actually all of them, but we're going to start with these first two individuals. Today, we welcome the American Legion Boys State Governor, Tyson Mitzel of Westport. Tyson's father is Stephen, and he is here as well. And we also have the girl state governor, Madison Mead of Sioux Falls, and her father, Peter. This was all put together by the American Legion on the boys' state, and the girls' state, of course, is the American Legion Auxiliary, and we'll applaud them after we recognize, ladies and gentlemen, our American Legion boys' state governor, American Legion women's auxiliary, Legion girls' state governor. Congratulations, governors. Also, if you'd stand as I introduce you, American Legion State Commander Rick McDonald, American Legion Auxiliary State President Janet Hurlbert, American Legion Boys State Director Jean Opruck, American Legion Auxiliary Girls State Director Cheryl Havorka, and American Legion State Adjutant Denny Brendan. Congratulations. Thank you for all you do. I have to say, these are labors of love for any of us who've been involved in it or been lucky enough to be in girls state or boys state, but at this time I need to embarrass Cheryl Havorka. Cheryl, will you please stand, raise your right hand, and swear to this oath? No, that's a different thing, Cheryl. I'll get you later, but Cheryl, you must stand pursuant to my order. Cheryl has been the leader, along with other supporting staff, down at the University of South Dakota in this area, as well as part of the American Legion Auxiliary. She has just been chosen, elected, blessed us by becoming the chairperson of the Northwest Division of the Girls Nation. Girls Nation, mind you. Cheryl then represents South Dakota, North Dakota, Minnesota, Montana, Wyoming, a whole bunch of other states, I think, is right. Cheryl, we're so proud of you, making us proud. Thank you very much, Cheryl. It's one of those things I do that I will pay for later, but it's really a privilege. We also have today, as you could tell, our first year medical students from the University of South Dakota School of Medicine. They were here yesterday. They had done work at the Peer Entering Learning Center and also a few of them stopped at St. Joe's and in Chamberlain. And it's really been a privilege to have you around today as first year students. A number of people have been presenting with them. And again, as we said when we got together, it's really an honor for us to have you in South Dakota, to be South Dakotans and all your varied background and be willing to serve in taking care of us in the future. So our first year medical students, welcome to your Senate. We also have Dr. Susan Anderson, who's with the first-year students, but she is the physician of the day, volunteering her time to take care of us, and we really appreciate you being here, doctor, and not only you, but the rest of the professionals. I'm not sure if the students know or anyone else, but doctors come every day to staff us, and they're volunteering their time, and it's very grateful. We're very grateful for that. So, Dr. Anderson, thank you. Is the Baltic class here, Mr. Senator Rave? Is Baltic class here yet? Okay. You don't see them, Senator Rave? Baltic class?
Not yet, sir.
Okay, thank you. I think right now we've got personal privileges. I'm sure there's a few of them. Oh, yes. Newly minted Senator Solano. This is your first personal privilege.
It is.
Let's get film.
Thank you, Mr. President, and good afternoon.
Good afternoon, sir.
I have the distinct pleasure of introducing my wife of 25 years, Carol Solano.
Carol. Any other personal privileges? Senator Kirkeby.
Thank you, Mr. President, members of the Senate. I have a distinct pleasure on following up with Senator Solano. I have been with Cheryl for 25 years, but she did, in fact, chase me for about 5 more years prior to that. But yeah. She finally caught me, but welcome, Cheryl. Thank you.
Any other personal privileges? Senator Teason.
Thank you, Mr. President, and my wife of, by my calculation, almost 34 years, Deb. Yay!
Any other personal privileges?
Senator Northrup.
Thank you, Mr. President. Every year I get the opportunity to introduce Representative David Northrup isn't on this half, so I get to introduce his mother. And but strange coincidence, as strange as this world is, also my wife.
Get out. Anyone else? Well, this doesn't happen very often for me because of how fast life is and everybody's obligations, but our son Colin is here today, and it's a real privilege to have him back. He kind of grew up here. Colin, just stand up so we can... And it's a twofer for me today. Ladies and gentlemen, the Second Lady of South Dakota, the First Lady of my heart, Karen. Okay, for you young people who aren't married, that's what you do to be a happy husband. All of us. It's so good to have you all here. Thank you very much. And would you please apprise me when they arrive, Senator? What we're going to do now, and we understand people have to come and go, and that's part of this transaction, but we go through a number of what we call housekeeping items to start with, and then we'll get to various parts of the calendar. A lot of this is red. A lot of things we do is because the Constitution requires it, and we didn't have computers when the Constitution was adopted in 1889. So we'll be going through that. You'll see people milling around until we get to the bulk of our work. Based on your schedules, we do have a couple of interesting bills when we get to the debate calendar. And so based, obviously, on the timing that you have, it's a privilege to have you here. Again, welcome to the South Dakota Senate, and we'll proceed now to communications and petitions.
The Honorable Matt Michaels. Dear President and members of the Senate, pursuant to the provisions of Section 42(7A)(17) of the South Dakota Codified Laws, and subject to your consent, I have the honor to inform you that I have reappointed James E. Putnam, Douglas County, Armour, South Dakota, to the South Dakota Lottery Commission. This appointment is effective immediately and shall continue until January 1, 2017. Sincerely, Dennis Dugard, Governor.
This appointment of Jim Putnam to South Dakota Lottery Commission is referred to appropriations for hearing. Reports of standing committees, please.
Mr. President, the Committee on Legislative Procedure respectfully reports that Senate Bills 30, 56, and 57 were delivered to His Excellency the Governor for his approval at 8:55 a.m. February 6, 2014. Respectfully, Corey Brown, Chair. The Committee on Education reports that it has had under consideration House Bill 1029 and recommends due pass, Senate Bill 97 and recommends due pass as amended, and Senate Bills 102 and 112, which were tabled. Senator Sohol, Chair. The Committee on Agriculture and Natural Resources reports that it has had under consideration House Bills 1012 and 1015 and recommends due pass. Senator Krebs, Chair. The Committee on Commerce and Energy reports that it has had under consideration House Bill 1045 and recommends due pass, Senate Bill 138 and recommends due pass consent, Senate Bill 115 and recommends due pass amended consent, and Senate Bill 92, which was tabled. Senator Holine, Chair. The Committee on Judiciary reports that it has had under consideration Senate Bill 25 and recommends due pass, Senate Bill 4, and recommends due pass as amended. Is there two there? And recommends that the Senate advise and consent to the reappointment of Don Holloway to the Board of Pardons and Paroles, consent, and advise and consent to the reappointment of Brian Zeeb to the South Dakota Interstate Commission for Adult Offender Supervision, consent, and the advise and consent to the appointment of Greg Erlinson of Kennington County, Rapid City, South Dakota, to the Board of Pardons and Paroles, and be placed on the consent calendar also. Senator Teason, Chair. The Committee on Judiciary also reports that it has had under consideration Senate Bill 6 and recommends due pass as amended.
Before we progress, I thought I saw Senator Quentin Berg. Where's Quentin? Where is he? Okay. I do see Senator Dick Kelly, Commissioner Kelly. It's good to see you. Welcome back, sir. Quentin thinks he's going to get introduced. He missed his chance, okay? No, we'll get him. Okay, we'll move on. Messages, please.
Mr. President, I have the honor to transmit herewith HCR 1011, which has been adopted by the House, and your concurrence is respectfully requested. Also, Mr. President, I have the honor to transmit herewith House Bills 1095, 1151, 1068, 1119, 1099, House Joint Resolution 1002, and House Bills 1108, 1113, 1100, and 1110, which have passed the House. I'm sorry. Let me start over, please. I have the honor to transmit herewith House Bill 1095, 1151, 1068, 1119, 1099, House Joint Resolution 1002, and House Bills 1108, 1113, 1100, and 1110, which have passed the House in your favorable consideration as respectfully requested. Arlene Kavislin, Chief Clerk.
Okay, motions and resolutions, please.
Senator Rabe moves that Senate Bill 98 and House Bill 1061 and House Concurrent Resolution 1010 be deferred to Monday, February 10th, the 17th legislative day.
Second.
All those in favor of deferral signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Those opposed, nay. Motion carried. They are so deferred.
Senator Brown moves that House Bills 1025 and 1046 be referred to the Committee on Government Operations and Audit.
All those in favor of re-referral signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Those opposed, nay. Motion carried.
Senator Rabe moves that when we adjourn today, we adjourn to convene at 1 o'clock p.m. on Friday, February 7th, the 16th legislative day.
All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Those opposed, nay. Motion carried.
House Concurrent Resolution 1011, a concurrent resolution endorsing Taiwan's participation in as an observer in the International Civil Aviation Organization and the 30th anniversary of sister state relations with the province of Taiwan in the Republic of China and Taiwan's inclusion in the Trans-Pacific Partnership.
Referral of committee to committee of House Concurrent Resolution 1011 is waived, and this will be placed on tomorrow's calendar, Friday, February 7th to 16th, legislative day. Before we proceed, Madam Secretary, I see it's, I can tell by the time of day, some of the logo wear, that this is Baltic, right? Baltic seniors, is that right? It's really great for you to be here. On behalf of Senator Rabe, the Majority Leader, And obviously, your Senate and us, Senator, we're really happy that you're here. We're just hitting our groove right now, so your time is good, and it's nice that you left the House. It's more enjoyable here. Way to go. Okay, Madam Secretary, call SCR 1.
Senate Concurrent Resolution Number 1, a concurrent resolution urging Congress to reject the proposal to remove the state's authority to designate a hospital as a necessary provider under the Critical Access Hospital Program. Senator Sutton moves that SCR 1, as found on page 223 of the Senate Journal, be adopted.
Comments on the motion. Senator Sutton, good afternoon.
Mr. President, good afternoon. Members of the body, the Critical Access Hospital Program was passed into law by Congress in 1997 to preserve the viability of more than 1,200 rural hospitals in the country. Today, we are sending a message to Congress, and more specifically, South Dakota Congressional Delegation, to resist a recommendation from the HHS Office of Inspector General. It's a recommendation for Congress to pass a law withdrawing states' long-established decisions allowing more of our rural hospitals to be paid by the Medicare program in a way that allows them to stay in business by designating them as necessary providers. In South Dakota, we have 38 critical access hospitals. If Congress did what the Office of Inspector General told them to do, 21 of those 38 critical access hospitals would be in jeopardy, including at least two in my district, and I'm sure in many of your districts. Back in 2006 and 2007, this state made some very wise and sound decisions to allow these 21 hospitals to be allowed to be critical access. SCR 1 asks Congress to respect those decisions made 8 years ago and not follow the advice it is getting from the Health and Human Services Office of Inspector General. I urge your support of SCR 1. Thank you.
Thank you, Senator Sutton. Further remarks? Hearing no further remarks, the question before the Senate is Senator Sutton's motion that SCR 1 be adopted. Those in favor of adoption will vote aye. Those opposed, nay. Madam Secretary, please call the roll.
Bogalka.
Aye.
Bradford.
Aye.
Brown.
Aye.
Bugh O'Donnell excused. Curd.
Aye.
Ewing.
Aye.
Ferrix excused. Heineman.
Aye.
Holeen. Hunhoff,
aye.
Jensen,
aye.
Chuck Jones,
aye.
Tom Jones,
aye.
Kirkaby,
aye.
Krebs,
aye.
Lederman,
aye.
Lucas,
aye.
Maher,
aye.
Monroe,
aye.
Norstrup,
aye.
Amdahl,
aye.
Otten,
aye.
Peters, Rampelberg,
aye.
Rave,
aye.
Roden.
Aye.
Soholt.
Aye.
Solano.
Aye.
Sutton.
Aye.
Tiedemann.
Aye.
Thiessen.
Aye.
Van Gerpen.
Aye.
Valley.
Aye.
Welke.
Aye.
White.
Aye.
Mr. President, there are ayes 33, excused 2.
Thank you, Madam Secretary. The question of Senator Sutton's motion that SCR 1 be adopted, having received a majority vote of the members elect, is hereby declared passed, and SCR 1 is so adopted. Consideration of committee reports.
Senator Rave moves that the report of the Standing Committee on State Affairs on Senate Bill 127 is found on page 221 of the Senate Journal be adopted.
All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Those opposed, nay. Motion carried. So adopted. First reading of House bills. These House bills need to be read in public according to our Constitution. Again, we didn't have computers, so we will have people reading at the same time, depending on the number of bills we have. Doesn't look like too many. But it's sort of strange to see somebody reading this when we have computers. Are you going to break them up? Are you going to do them all? But you have to remember, since we didn't have computers when the Constitution was adopted, people would keep track of the title and the bill number, and then I'll announce where the President Pro Tem has assigned the bills. And obviously it was the old pencil and paper or pen and paper idea. Now we keep track of it on computer, but we still must read. First reading of House bills. Thank you.
House Bill 1113, an act to make an appropriation to fund tax refunds for elderly persons and persons with a disability and to declare an emergency. House Bill 1110, an act to revise certain provisions regarding the definition of a resident for the purposes of hunting, fishing, and trapping licenses. House Bill 1068, an act to revise provisions relating to the use of dogs in hunting mountain lions. House Bill 1108, an act to repeal certain outdated and obsolete provisions regarding employment strikes and lockouts. House Bill 1002, House Joint Resolution 1002, a joint resolution proposing and submitting to the electors at the next general election an amendment to Article 3, Section 6 of the Constitution of the State of South Dakota relating to legislative term limits. House Bill 1099, an act to revise the membership of the State Investment Council. House Bill 1100, an act to prohibit the use of certain photo radar speed detection systems and of certain photo monitoring devices to detect red light violations. House Bill 1119, an act to revise certain provisions relating to preliminary hearings for persons charged with Class 1 misdemeanors. House Bill 1095, an act to revise and clarify certain provisions relating to municipal officers. House Bill 1151, an act to revise certain deadlines in offices regarding budgetary planning for municipalities.
President announces the following assignments made by the President Pro Tem of the Senate to the respective committees. House Bill 1068, Agriculture and Natural Resources. Appropriations receives House Bill 1113, 1108, Commerce, 1110, Health and Human Services, Judiciary, 1100, and 1119, 1095, and 1151 to local government. House Joint Resolution 1002 to State Affairs, as well as House Bill 1099. Ladies and gentlemen of the Senate, the following bill was read on January 23rd and is now being referred. These bills are House Bills 1050 and 51 are both being referred to State Affairs as of this date. The following bill was read on January 24th, and House Bill 1054 is also referred to State Affairs. On January 15th, Senate Bill 46 was first read and today is referred to the Committee on Agriculture and Natural Resources. Our next order of business is consent calendar. These consent calendar are comprised of bills that were non-controversial. They're bills that had unanimous support, met certain criteria in committee. And again, since they're not controversial, the committee says, let's not debate them. We have other matters and work to do, so it's put on what we call the consent calendar. Now, questions may be asked of the sponsor of the bill, but also any individual senator. Just one senator can pull it, and then it would be debated. And so although it's for efficiency, it doesn't eliminate the ability to have a check and balance internally. And we do have one of those today. Otherwise, we in the Senate vote on consent calendars as one group. So we're going to our consent calendar bills right now. Madam Secretary, thank you.
Senator Brown requested that Senate Bill 82 be removed from the consent calendar. Senate Bill 68, an act to adopt the Uniform Real Property Electronic Recording Act, to use an existing funding source to implement the provisions of this act, and to revise certain provisions concerning electronic recording. Senate Bill 95, an act to revise certain vehicle dealer licensing provisions. House Bill 1044, an act to authorize limited cosmetology services outside of a licensed salon or booth. House Bill 1047, an act to revise various trust and trust company provisions. House Bill 1057, an act to repeal certain provisions imposing the inheritance tax and the estate tax.
Thank you. Senate Bill 6895 and House Bills 1044, 1047, and 1057, having received a second reading, are up for consideration and final passage. Are there any questions on any of these bills? Hearing none, ladies and gentlemen of the Senate, the question before the Senate is final passage of Senate Bill 68, 95, and House Bills 1044, 1047, and 1057. Those in favor of passage will vote aye. Those opposed, nay. Madam Secretary, will you please call the roll?
Bogalka.
Aye.
Bradford.
Aye.
Brown.
Aye.
Buell O'Donnell excused. Curd.
Aye.
Ewing.
Aye.
Ferrix excused. Heineman.
Aye.
Holine.
Aye.
Hunhoff.
Aye.
Jensen.
Aye.
Chuck Jones.
Aye.
Tom Jones.
Aye.
Kirkaby.
Aye.
Krebs.
Aye.
Lederman.
Aye.
Lucas.
Aye.
Maher.
Aye.
Monroe.
Aye.
Nordstrup.
Aye.
Amdahl.
Aye.
Otten.
Aye.
Peters.
Aye.
Rampelberg. Rave.
Aye.
Roden.
Aye.
Soholt.
Aye.
Solano.
Aye.
Sutton.
Aye.
Tiedemann.
Aye.
Thiessen.
Aye.
Van Gerpen.
Aye.
Valley.
Aye.
Welke.
Aye.
White.
Aye.
Mr. President, there were ayes 33, excused 2.
Thank you. Senate Bill 6895 and House Bills 1044, 1047, and 1057, having received a majority vote of the members elect, are all hereby declared passed. Are there any questions on any of these titles? They're approved then. Thank you. We're on to our debate calendar. Second reading of Senate bills.
Senate Bill 113, an act to revise the minimum suspension requirements for students participating in extracurricular activities.
Senate Bill 113, having received a second reading, is up for consideration and final passage. Senator Rave, comments, please.
Thank you, Mr. President. Mr. President, ladies and gentlemen of the Senate, this summer I was approached by one of my superintendents about an issue arose in their school district. And it was dealing with the minimum suspension requirements for students who participate in extracurricular activities. Ladies and gentlemen, this is a good example of the process of making law. This law actually went into place during Governor Janklow's second term. I've been around here long enough. We revisited this issue in Governor Round's first term. It made some changes, and at that time I had some heartburn about it as well, but I'll get into that in a little bit. And now we're proposing to fix some of those changes under the Governor Dugard administration. So it's a good process. We make laws, we come back, we change, adjust, and tweak as necessary. Ladies and gentlemen, this summer what happened, I will obviously change the story a little bit, but it's a common story amongst many schools and many districts. Two young men got into a little trouble over the summer with some illegal drugs. They both were thrown into the criminal process. One young man adjudicated his charges immediately and began his extracurricular suspension the beginning of golf season, which is typically the second week of August, give or take. The other young man waited to adjudicate his sentence until after the football season. Both young men were football players. Well, you can already see what happened. One young man missed the entire season, was punished by missing all the games. The other young man missed no games, began serving his 60-day suspension at the end of the football season, and since they didn't play basketball or participate in track, there really was never a punishment from that perspective. To clarify, this is not being soft on crime. They've already gone through the criminal process. They've paid any fines, served any applicable time if that was the case. This has nothing to do with being soft on crime. This has to do with adding another deterrent to young people to not do drugs. On the other hand, it also allows those young people to, again, participate in extracurricular activities and not be punished for an entire season. So when the superintendent approached me, I said I would be willing to take a look at this process if he would be willing to address one of my concerns that I had had when we addressed this during the Governor Round's administration. And that was, right now students can game the system, if you will. They can wait to do drugs till after the current sport that they're in and never miss any sports. The Attorney General ruled that summer school can be added into the time that they can that counts towards their missing activities. Well, we don't play a lot of summer football, so there really isn't any issue there. So you can see the unfairness of it all. And so the superintendent I worked with, I told him what I thought we needed to do, and he really came up with, I think, a brilliant compromise. What we're talking about here is setting the minimum for local school districts. Again, that is important. I want to clarify, this is the minimum. Local school districts can certainly go above and beyond what you would allow me to pass out of here today. This sets a minimum. We're talking about changing really two things. One, the current 60 school day suspension to 30 calendar days. Now, it seems like a drastic change, and it is. But if you think about that, football season, you're still missing half the season. Missing, you know, 4 or 5 games depending upon the timing. And it also then implements something we've never had. a specific sport suspension. So if you don't play football, then your suspension, play that same scenario out. During the summer, you are caught doing illegal drugs. You start serving that suspension on the second week of August. That's completed during the middle of football. But if you don't participate in football, in theory, your suspension has been served. What this bill does is make sure that, let's say you're a basketball player, you're going to miss a minimum of 2 basketball games when that starts. So you've already done your 30 days, which really wasn't a punishment because you weren't banned from anything that you wanted to participate in. You now miss 2 basketball games. So it addresses a concern I had dealing with an issue of fairness. And in closing, ladies and gentlemen, I think what this also does is dovetails into what we did last year with Senate Bill 70. We recognize as times change and things evolve that we are all about deterring people from making poor choices. But we're also about allowing people to make up for that, and in this case, participate in activities that keep them out of trouble instead of banning them from an entire season and then encouraging them to be idle and have more time to get into more trouble. With that, ladies and gentlemen, I would close, stand down for any questions. Mr. President, I thank you for your time and attention.
Thank you, Senator Ray. Further remarks? Senator Teason.
Thank you, Mr. President. I would just add, having a long history in working with youth sports, that I think this bill accomplishes two things, and it's particularly important for our youth, and that is that this bill is fair and it's consistent. And for those two reasons, I'd ask you to support it.
Thank you, Senator. Further remarks? Senator Solano.
Thank you, Mr. President. And I also rise in support of this bill. Already written into the law, which I think is an important element, is that the youth that is subject to this will go through an assessment by a certified chemical dependency counselor. So we're really directing them in the, you know, into the right direction. If they need treatment, we're moving them towards that, towards getting the treatment that they need. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Further remarks? Hearing no further remarks, the question for the Senate is final passage of Senate Bill 113. Those in favor will vote aye. Those opposed, nay. Madam Secretary, please call the roll.
Pagalka.
Aye.
Bradford.
Aye.
Brown.
Aye.
Bugh O'Donnell, excused. Curd.
Aye.
Ewing.
Aye.
Frerichs, excused. Heineman.
Aye.
Holleen.
Aye.
Hunhoff.
Aye.
Jensen.
Aye.
Chuck Jones.
Aye.
Tom Jones. Kirkaby,
aye.
Krebs,
aye.
Lederman,
aye.
Lucas,
aye.
Maher,
aye.
Monroe,
aye.
Northrup,
aye.
Amdahl,
aye.
Otten,
aye.
Peters,
aye.
Rampelberg,
aye.
Rave,
aye.
Roden,
aye.
Soholt,
aye.
Solano,
aye.
Sutton,
aye.
Tiedemann,
aye.
Teason,
aye.
Van Gerpen, Valley, Welke, White. Mr. President, there were ayes 32, nays 1, excused 2.
Senate Bill 113, having received a majority vote of the members-elect, is hereby declared passed. Are there any questions on the title? Title is approved then.
Senate Bill 91, an act to revise certain licensure definitions and provide certain regulatory powers to municipalities.
Senate Bill 91, having received a second reading, is up for consideration and final passage. Senator Krebs, good afternoon, ma'am.
Thank you, Mr. President. Members of the Senate, Senate Bill 91, if you read what it does, it says it's an act to revise certain licensures. Specifically in line 5, we're dealing with current statute. There is no change as far as who the carrier is. If you're a carrier in a local community, and a carrier is a limousine, a bus, you know, those are what we define as carriers. These carriers must apply in current statute under Title 35. They must apply for a license through Department of Revenue. It goes directly to Revenue for the ability to serve alcohol while they're operating and on the streets. Again, a carrier being a limo or a bus. What drew the interest and what spurred this bill was the fact of a taxi cab. Is also drawing interest in this area. In Sioux Falls particularly, a taxi cab company is wanting to do that as well, become a carrier, of course, but being able to be a carrier that can serve alcohol while providing the services on the streets. And that's where the concern became with the safety and law enforcement, is how do you enforce that? You know, you have the driver of the taxi cab that is doing the driving, but is he also the one doing the serving and providing the alcohol? And how are we going to control that? So what Senate Bill 91 does is, if you look in line 6 on that, it states in there, unless restricted by local ordinance. This allows our municipalities, which again, it's been supported by the Municipal League, our municipalities to be able to control this and be able to set up and establish exactly who in their municipality is a carrier, define that further, and if they're going to allow these types of taxi cabs, if they want to still be extended, in their communities. There's also interest in an investment opportunity for some businesses called pedal pubs, and we're seeing this on a national level. This is just a sidebar, but most importantly, we're addressing the concern of the taxi cabs trying to extend their services by providing alcohol and serving alcohol. We're putting in this language that says, let's allow a local ordinance determine if they want these carriers to be able to do this. With that said, Mr. President, I appreciate your support of Senate Bill 91.
Thank you, Senator. Further remarks, Senator Amdahl. Good afternoon.
I got a question for the sponsor.
State your question, Senator.
Is there a division? I'm looking at a taxi cab and then we'll say a limo. Is there a division between both autos?
Senator Krebs, do you wish to answer the question, ma'am?
Yes, please, Mr. President. And the senator from Minnehaha County, in your backyard, that was the intention here, is there is no definition of what a carrier is. And that was a question we had in committee. So let's let the local ordinances and local municipalities define carriers for them and each one of them on their own. And that's what they intend to do here, is let that local ordinance say if a carrier is only a limo or only a bus, or that may include also a taxi cab or not, by restricting that.
Senator Amdahl, you have the floor, sir.
Yeah, I'd like further question.
State your question.
So therefore, it's up to the municipalities whether to allow a shield between, we'll say, the partiers and the driver, and it's not going to be a state issue.
Senator Krebs, right? Do you wish to answer the question?
President, I mean, when you say shield, are you talking like a physical plastic shield, or are you saying?
Senator Amdahl?
Yeah, I'm talking about a division, a physical division between the driver and the partiers.
Senator Krebs.
Thank you, Mr. President. Sorry about that.
No problem.
That's something, I guess, if they wanted to determine that in ordinance, they could. I think really, though, they want to look beyond that and saying, do we have a division there? Do we have a law enforcement guard, so to speak, you know, like in a car, a law enforcement car? But I think the concern is really safety. That's really too close, and that's really the concern, is how close they are to their passengers in that taxi cab.
Senator Amdahl, you have the floor.
No further questions.
Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Further remarks? Senator Bradford. Good afternoon.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. I have a question as sponsor.
State your question, sir.
If we're riding double, can the guy in the back drink on my horse?
Mr. President.
Senator Krebs, it's actually an image in my brain that I just can't get out of there again.
I actually think, if I remember, maybe Mr. Lieutenant Governor, you can help me, but I think we repealed some of those statutes about DUIs and riding horses.
But not for Senator Bradford, we haven't. Senator Bradford, you have the floor. Mercifully, you give it up. Further remarks? Hearing no further remarks, the question before the Senate is final passage of Senate Bill 91. Those in favor will vote aye. Those opposed, nay. Secretary, please call the roll.
Begalka.
Aye.
Bradford.
Aye.
Brown.
No.
Buell O'Donnell, excused. Curd.
No.
Ewing.
No.
Frericks, excused. Heineman.
Aye.
Holeen.
No.
Hunhoff. Jensen.
No.
Chuck Jones.
Pass.
Tom Jones.
Aye.
Kirkaby.
Aye.
Krebs.
Aye.
Lederman.
Aye.
Lucas.
Aye.
Maher.
No.
Monroe.
No.
Nordstrup.
Aye.
Amdahl.
No.
Otten.
No.
Peters.
No.
Rampelberg.
No.
Rave.
No.
Roden.
No.
Soholt.
Yes.
Solano.
No.
Sutton.
No.
Tiedemann.
No.
Thiessen.
Aye.
Van Gerpen.
Aye.
Valley.
No.
Welke.
Aye.
White.
No.
Chuck Jones.
Aye.
Sutton.
No.
Mr. President, there are ayes 15, nays 18, excused 2.
Senate Bill 91, having failed to receive a majority vote of the members elect, is hereby declared lost. Senator Cripps.
Thank you, Mr. President. I move to reconsider.
Thank you. Your notice of intent to reconsider the vote by which Senate Bill 91 is lost is so noted and put in the record.
Senate Bill 103, an act to establish certain civil penalties for tampering or removing any highway marker, sign, or control device, and to distribute the revenue from such civil penalties.
Senate Bill 103, having received a second reading, is up for consideration and final passage. Are there any remarks? Senator Valley, good afternoon, sir.
Thank you. Good afternoon to you. Senate Bill 103 is a highway safety bill that's built to reduce taxpayer cost in maintaining and replacing highway signs and markers and guideposts. And it's meant for all divisions of government, whether it's state, township, towns, or counties. And what it would do is it would provide a civil penalty of up to $2,000 in addition to the civil or to the criminal penalties out there currently. Currently, it is a Class 1 misdemeanor with a $1,000 fine. But the rationale for this is that generally these people are hard to find. And if you'll look on your desk, I put one, I think there's one put on each pair of desks. And it's a picture of several signs that the township people just went out and took a few days ago so that you can see what's happening. A lot of times these signs are pulled up and just laid over. Sometimes they are shot up. And this also presents a liability when these signs are gone to the local governments, whether it's the townships or the counties. This is looked at as a deterrent method. In fact, a couple of the people that testified said what they wanted to do was to take a couple of these shot up signs, put it in the treasurer's office with a note on it that, you know, if you are found guilty of this, it's up to a $2,000 civil penalty, and hoping that you will get the education out there and get people to understand that this is not what you want to be doing. As most of you know that live in the country or drive out in the country, these roads are not heavily patrolled. There's not a lot of highway patrolmen out there. There's not a lot of sheriff patrol cars out there, so it's very hard to find. But when you do find someone, they want to have the ability to say, you know, this is costing the taxpayer money, and the money that goes into this doesn't go into fixing the roads. And they're expensive. They run from about, to put in a new sign costs from $173 to about $233, depending upon the sign and where it's at. There were a couple questions that were asked that I want to give some answers to. One was, what happens if it's an accident? I slide off a slippery road and I take out the sign. If you look on the bill on line 8, it says intentionally. So if you have an accident, that's not intentional. It does not count towards this. The second question was asked is, does this limit the liability of the person that pulled out the sign? So in other words, someone pulls out a curve sign and then someone goes through that curve and he wants to sue the person because they found out who took out the sign. Does this $2,000 limit that liability? No, it doesn't. This is only for taking out of the sign, and as it says there, the money, that $2,000 or whatever it comes out of that civil penalty, is distributed to the state or the political subdivision within the jurisdiction where that highway was at. So this is not meant to cover any other civil case that may occur. And with that, as you know, I'm always trying to protect the money for our roads and to keep them in good shape, and to waste it by having to put on new signs because some people want to shoot at them. I'm a hunter. I won't say I'm a great hunter, but I don't have to prove how good a shot I am by shooting at a sign. If I can't hit a sign, I just as well give up the sport. So I urge you to support this bill so that the counties and townships and municipalities can put their money into the roads rather than having to replace signs. Because by law, by federal law, they have to keep these up to a certain standard, and if they don't, they then can be liable for civil penalties because they have not kept up their signs. And I could give instances. I'm not going to bore you with those, but it is dangerous when they start pulling out these signs. Thank you, Mr. President, and members of the body.
Thank you, Senator Valley. Further remarks on Senate Bill 103? Any further remarks? Hearing none, the question before the Senate is final passage of Senate Bill 103. It requires two-thirds majority vote for passage because it's a continuous appropriation and a fund that's outside of the general fund. Any questions? Hearing none. Again, the question before the Senate is final passage of Senate Bill 103. Those in favor will vote aye. Those opposed, nay. Two-thirds majority vote requested and required. Madam Secretary, please call the roll.
Bogalka.
Aye.
Bradford.
Aye.
Brown.
Aye.
Buell O'Donnell excused. Curd.
Aye.
Ewing.
Aye.
Ferrix excused. Heineman.
Aye.
Holine.
Aye.
Hunhoff.
Aye.
Jensen. Chuck Jones, Tom Jones, Kirkaby, Krebs, Lederman, Lucas, Maher, Monroe, Nordstrup, Amdahl, Otten, Peters, excuse me, Senator Peters, no, Rampelberg, Rave, Roden, Soholt.
Aye.
Solano.
Aye.
Sutton.
Aye.
Tiedemann.
Aye.
Thiessen.
Aye.
Van Gerpen.
Aye.
Valley.
Aye.
Welke.
Aye.
White.
Aye.
Mr. President, there were ayes 31, nays 2, excused 2.
Senate Bill 103, having received a two-thirds majority vote of the members-elect, is hereby declared passed. Any questions on the title? The title's approved then. Going to second reading of House bills.
House Bill 1049, an act to establish and revise certain provisions regarding the South Dakota Athletic Commission.
House Bill 1049, having received a second reading, is up for consideration and final passage. Remarks, Senator Lederman, good afternoon.
Good afternoon. Thank you, Mr. President and members of the Senate. I come before you today with House Bill 1049, which is a bill that was brought by the South Dakota Athletic Commission. You might all remember the commission because last year we formed it through legislature, and we also requested that the governor appoint a commission. And as we have sat here this year, we've filled that by approving the nominations that the governor has made to fill this commission. But what we didn't do is we didn't give direction for the commission. We created the commission. We told them the main points of what we wanted handled, but we failed to give them the rulemaking authority and the guidance to go ahead and implement all the things that we wanted them to do, which was administer the rules and regulations of boxing and fighting in South Dakota. I'll read just one part of the bill. Section 25 expands and clarifies the commission's rulemaking authority to allow the commission to determine the rules to govern competitions and sparring exhibitions. I think that pretty much sums the bill up. It goes into great detail about the exact detail of what they have to do as far as setting the fees for each event, about the meetings, when they meet, and it goes into the liability coverage that would be required by the by the people who are in charge of the productions. Other than that, I urge your support for House Bill 1049. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Further remarks on House Bill 1049? Hearing none, the question before the Senate is final passage of House Bill 1049 requires two-thirds majority vote for passage. Those in favor will vote aye. Those opposed, nay. Secretary will call the roll, please.
Bogalka.
Aye.
Bradford.
Aye.
Brown.
Aye.
Bugh O'Donnell excused. Kurd.
Aye.
Ewing. Frerichs excused. Heineman.
Aye.
Holleen.
Aye.
Hunhoff.
Aye.
Jensen.
Aye.
Chuck Jones.
Aye.
Tom Jones. Kirkaby.
Aye.
Krebs. Lederman.
Aye.
Lucas. Maher.
Aye.
Monroe.
Aye.
Nordstrup. Amdahl.
Aye.
Otten.
Aye.
Peters.
No.
Rampelberg.
Aye.
Rave.
Aye.
Roden.
Aye.
Soholt.
Aye.
Solano.
Aye.
Sutton.
Aye.
Tiedemann.
Aye.
Thiessen.
Aye.
Van Gerpen.
No.
Valley.
No.
Welke.
Aye.
White. Krebs, aye. Lucas, excused. Mr. President, there are ayes 28, nays 4, excused 3.
House Bill 1049, having received a two-thirds majority vote of the members elect, is hereby declared passed. Any questions on this title? The title's approved then.
House Bill 1070, an act to sunset certain tax refund claims for an economic development incentive program that has been previously terminated and to declare an emergency.
House Bill 1070, having received a second reading, is up for consideration and final passage. Remarks, Senator Tiedemann, good afternoon.
Thank you, Mr. President, and good afternoon to you.
Thank you.
Members of the body, House Bill 1070 will start the process of winding down SDCL 10-44 45B refund program, the contractor's excise sales and use tax on construction. Under the old program, sales use and contractor's excise tax were set aside for those qualifying projects to be paid out when the proper paperwork was put in. The hope was to put the dollars into this liability account within the Department of Revenue and that it would be paid out in the same year that it was put in. However, construction projects don't get done quite as quickly, and so that fund stayed there until all the paperwork is done, you cannot pay it out. This bill will put an end to some of those projects, give them an ending date. In 2012 was the end of that program. A year later, we still have dollars that are in this liability account that we as a state still owe if they come forward and claim. Legislation that was passed in 2010 said that you could request a refund once the construction project was started. After 1-1-2010, you had 36 months to complete the project and then 12 months more to submit the refund request. However, all of those programs that were started before that date, there's no end date. So we still have this liability. This bill will put an end date to that. There was $30 million in that account. $19.4 million was placed in the FY14 budget to cover some one-time expenditures. That leaves about $10 million out there of liability. The goal is that by May 1st of 2014, they will have to submit their request. All of these operators have been notified. We have their name, we have their address. They have been notified by Department of Revenue, and they know that they have to submit the proper paperwork to get this done. If they do not make that request, or if they make the request and we have some time to banner back and forth on proper paperwork, they have until September 1st to complete it. If they do not make the request, those dollars will then go into the general fund, and so it becomes available to spend on general fund items for the general operation of the state. This, again, puts an end date to it. It makes them move forward, and we remove this future liability that we have at the current time. I urge your support of House Bill 1070.
Thank you, Senator Tiedemann. Further remarks? Hearing no further remarks, the question before the Senate is final passage of House Bill 1070. It does have an emergency clause and therefore requires two-thirds majority vote for passage. Those in favor will vote aye. Those opposed, nay. Madam Secretary, please call the roll.
Pagalka.
Aye.
Bradford.
Aye.
Brown.
Aye.
Buell, Donald excused. Kurd.
Aye.
Ewing.
Aye.
Frerichs excused. Heineman.
Aye.
Holleen.
Aye.
Hunhoff. Jensen,
aye.
Chuck Jones,
aye.
Tom Jones,
aye.
Kirkaby,
aye.
Krebs,
aye.
Lederman,
aye.
Lucas excused, Maher,
aye.
Monroe,
no.
Northrup,
aye.
Amdahl,
aye.
Otten,
aye.
Peters,
aye.
Rampelberg, Rave.
Aye.
Roden.
Aye.
Soholt.
Aye.
Solano.
Aye.
Sutton.
Aye.
Tiedemann.
Aye.
Thiessen.
Aye.
Van Gerpen.
Aye.
Valley.
Aye.
Welke.
Aye.
White.
Aye.
Mr. President, there were ayes 31, nays 1, excused 3.
House Bill 1070, having received two-thirds majority vote of the members-elect, is hereby declared passed. Any questions on the title? Hearing none, the title's approved. That is our calendar today. Ladies and gentlemen of the Senate, I know that you've been provided this information, but I was informed by the Adjutant General. He wanted to make sure that you all knew this, that because of the American Legion legislative reception and obviously our dining out tonight through the National Guard, those had some conflict in their scheduling, and so they've adjusted their schedules. The American Legion reception is now from 4:30 until 7, 4:30 to 7 at the log cabin, so it goes up until 7. National Guard legislative dining out, that reception starts at 6, but the actual program's at 7:30. So if you desire to go with both of them, they've adjusted their schedules accordingly. The National Guard dining out, for you, who obviously that can be pretty long at that hour, but they tried to shorten some aspects of the program also to accommodate that, so should be done by 9:30, but it'll be a great evening. Again, 4:30 is the American Legion up until 7, and then 6 to 7:30 is the reception for the dining out. 7:30 will be the program commencement. Thank you. Announcements. Any announcements? Okay. That's it. I should probably do that. Senator Peters, no announcements? You're good? Okay. The Constitution requires the presiding officer sign bills that pass both the House and the Senate, read their title while in open session. The President is signing House Bill 1024, an act to place certain substances on the controlled substance schedule and declare an emergency. And the President is signing an act to revise certain provisions regarding references to the Internal Revenue Code, House Bill 1055. Any other announcements? Okay, Madam Secretary, you're on.
Senator Krebs moves that the Senate do now adjourn.
All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Those opposed, nay. Motion carried. We are adjourned. Thank you all, and thank you for our guests.
State House program funding provided by the South Dakota Bar Foundation, the educational and charitable arm of South Dakota lawyers and judges.